This video is rated M for mature. It's 1998. Sony and Nintendo are living it big with their current consoles, the PlayStation and the Nintendo 64. In addition, Microsoft and Apple are putting some awesome games on their Windows and Macintosh computers, and Sega is releasing the Dreamcast in Japan. This year would see the release of juggernauts like Metal Gear Solid and Resident Evil 2 on the PlayStation, Half-Life and Unreal on computers, and on the N64, F-Zero X, Zelda Ocarina of Time, and our feature presentation, Turok 2, Seeds of Evil. Critics praised the sequel to the first Turok like crazy. IGN gave it a 9 out of 10, GameSpot also gave a 9 out of 10, N64 Magazine 95%, 9.2 out of 10 in Nintendo Power, and an 86 out of 100 on Metacritic, just to name a few. Turok started out as a comic book series by Western Publishing in the 1950s, telling the story of a man and his brother in a strange world inhabited by dinosaurs and other fascinating things. Simply put, this is the basis of the franchise. In 1993, Valiant Comics launched a new volume called Turok Dinosaur Hunter, which is what the Nintendo 64 game of the same name is based on. Dinosaur Hunter the game can be seen as an innovator in FPS controls on consoles. By default, the C buttons on the right move you while the control stick is used for aiming. It's not like today where we are so used to moving with a left joystick and looking with the right one. The game was also one of the first FPS titles to utilize full outdoor environments for exploration and truly inventive weapons. Turok Dinosaur Hunter's gameplay in a nutshell is a big scavenger hunt for level keys with lots of platforming segments. The first Turok was a big success, selling 1.5 million copies and escalating sales of the Nintendo 64. A sequel was inevitable, and Seeds of Evil was born. In this video, we'll be viewing the remastered edition by Night Dive Studios, released for different platforms starting in 2017. The original N64 edition has several major flaws that the remaster addresses, though a few problems remain. First, however, let's talk about the good points. The opening insignias are impressive. The acclaim letters are shot from off-screen, and for the Iguana Entertainment logo, the iguana is also shot at, but retaliates by murdering the off-screen attacker with two large guns. That's quite the contrast to NBA Jam, where all the iguana does is spin a basketball. The story of Turok 2 is basic in tone, however, its elements are what make it wonderful. You are Joshua Fireseed, tasked by a woman named Adon to stop an entity called the Primogen from escaping the confines of his lightship. Five powerful objects called energy totems prevent the Primogen to take leave, but several villainous races are willing to help free him by taking the totems apart. If successful, a blast wave of temporal energy will be let loose and Joshua's universe will go bye-bye. That would be enough motivation to play the game, but all the levels have their own captivating tales as well. For instance, in one level, a city falls victim to enemy forces because their army was weakened due to years of luxury and peace, and in another, a race of giant insects create rift gates to invade and conquer other worlds. The audio is top-notch, voice acting is mostly good, and the sound effects are magnificent. The music is also excellent. The artistic tunes for each level invoke a distinctive feeling concerning the setting and the problems at hand. The remaster has an option to play either the N64 or PC soundtracks. However, it's the vast weapon arsenal and enemy types that make this game compelling. For instance, we have dinosaurs that fire plasma spheres and throw explosives, large apes that wield massive swords and wear strong armor, and zombies that shoot fireballs. In terms of weapons, you'll see the usual. The starting melee weapon, pistol, shotgun, grenade launcher, and machine gun. But the rest of the arsenal puts lots of other shooters to shame. I'll only be discussing a few examples, which means the cerebral bore is excluded since it's been talked about to death. The tech bow can fire both normal arrows and explosive arrows, and it also utilizes a sniper capability. In addition, it pulls arrows back faster and launches them farther than the wooden bow. Using regular arrows early on is a good way to conserve ammunition because they can be recovered most of the time. The plasma rifle almost completely replaces the tech bow because it's a hitscan gun, a gun that, when fired, instantly hits whatever it's pointing at. The warblade can score 3 hits with one swing and is good against small and charging enemies, making it useful throughout the whole adventure. You'll also chance upon 2 stun weapons, a tranquilizer gun and a charge dart rifle. The tranquilizer gun can put only a few enemy types to sleep, whereas the charge dart rifle incapacitates anyone. These 2 weapons are also convenient for conserving ammo because you can use the warblade to finish the foe off while they're helpless. Now wait a minute. The player stuns a monster and follows up with a melee attack? That sounds familiar. Yeah, it's just like the 1-2 punch from Bioshock, except Turok 2 did it first. Continuing on, the Razor Wind is that shuriken boomerang I once talked about in my discussion of Turok 3 in my top 5 greatest first-person shooters. It typically kills in one hit, can be used infinitely, and if it hits an organic target, it'll be covered in blood once it returns to you. It isn't very accurate, but still fun to try out. I want to mention the PFM layer as well. It fires proximity mines, which doesn't sound so special, but here's the catch. The mines do not harm you. This weapon is quite useful in tight spaces. There are even underwater weapons, a harpoon gun and a torpedo launcher. The latter doubles as a propulsion device, enhancing your maneuverability while submerged. A word of advice, Joshua swims very quickly when the torpedo launcher is not in use, though he moves sort of like he's locked down on a grid. I suggest fast swimming through wide areas and straightaways, and for tighter areas, have the torpedo launcher at the ready. The last weapon example comes in the form of a dinosaur called a Styracosaurus in level 2 that you can ride. Both its firearms, a double-barreled grenade launcher and assault rifle, have unlimited ammunition. The Styracosaurus can also trample and gore adversaries. Use its horn attack for an increase in speed. Selecting a means of offense is a piece of cake. Seeds of Evil has the weapon wheel, the console version of a computer keyboard. First, hold the primary or secondary weapons button, then highlight the weapon of choice in its respective direction, and presto! It's in your hands at once. For its time, and even by today's standards, this is a genius move by Iguana Entertainment.
Now, I'll discuss some changes specific to the Remastered Edition.
Right off the bat, controls are fully customizable. Originally, there were only 2 presets, and worse, there was the lack of a controller display. So unless you had the instruction booklet or looked at an online guide, you wouldn't know which controller parts do what until you started playing. The next refinement is the ability to skip most in-game cutscenes. In previous versions, players could not. Don't you just hate that? The remastered frame rate is now 100% consistent at 60 frames per second. The N64 port suffers from large drops in animation frames, and it made combat more difficult than it should have been. Explosive weapons have also been improved. In the original, for some odd reason, when you fired explosives at an enemy, the hits don't register sometimes. That snag has been fixed. The best improvements start with a field of view slider and extended draw distance. Now you can see further ahead and more things around you. The distance fog in the N64 port, also present in the remaster, is problematic due to the fact that some obscured enemies can instantly spot you, but you don't know their positions before they discover yours. When you max out your extra lives at 9 by collecting 100 life force objects, you still pick them up, but Joshua stops obtaining them at 99. In the old game, players were at the mercy of rolling the life force counter over to 0. What this means is, even after you reach the highest amount of lives possible, you still pick up life forces at 99, sacrificing a chance or two to gain more extra lives if any are lost. The hint system is another godsend. Important things are highlighted with exclamation points. Because the game's levels are packed to the rafters with branching pathways, walkways, teleporters, and floors, missing a crucial destination can be very easy. The hint guide eases that problem. Another dash of modern gaming is the ledge grab. Joshua can now pull himself up onto higher areas and platforms without the hassle of extra traveling or timed jumps. It's also useful for getting out of a bad jam. The looking controls in the N64 port are sloppy. When on inclined surfaces, Joshua automatically faces in the direction the slope is going. Also, whenever players move forward or backward when looking up or down, Joshua returns to looking straight ahead. Often, it leads to disorientation, and disabling the look spring option doesn't help. In the remaster, those problems are absent. The maximum amount of health points has changed to 250% instead of 200%. This makes it easier to handle the harder difficulties. There's a neat trick that makes the harder difficulties even more fair. Normally, when you lose a life, some enemies you killed before on the same map respawn. But if you disable the player death cinematics, nobody will come back to life when you die. Nintendo 64 players have to rely on stations with violet portals to save their game. This wouldn't be so bad if it wasn't for the fact that save stations are scarce, only around 2 to 4 in each level. So in addition to reaching objectives and finding crucial artifacts, you must travel back the same way you came lots of times just to record your blasted progress. And out of all the games that have save points, the N64 Turok 2 is one of the worst. But hallelujah, players are now able to save their progress anywhere, just like in the old PC edition.
Game saved.
I was ecstatic to see this improvement. For the first time, console players aren't fresh out of luck. The original save points are now checkpoint stations. You can still max out your health and ammo here like before, one time that is, but now these places double as warp points. Once you pinpoint one of these things, you can simply teleport back to the hub as well as any of the other checkpoint stations you encountered beforehand, regardless of what world they're in. What Nintendo 64 players have to do to leave worlds is search for a level exit all over again. So instead of having a quick way to depart, traversing the same super long stretch of ground to either the very beginning or the very end is mandatory. Once again, another dreadful problem rectified thanks to Night Dive Studios.
The pros have been explained, now it's time for the cons.
The first constant issue is random damage. Enemies have body-specific damage, meaning that a headshot will take them down in a flash, whereas the other body parts require multiple hits for a kill. This was also featured in GoldenEye, but the damage there was balanced, resulting in about 2 to 6 shots below the head to murder regular people, depending on the difficulty. The creatures of Turok 2 at random intervals will either be as weak as a stick of butter or as tough as a car door. For instance, you might defeat someone with 2 pistol blasts, but other times, they'll take around 8 shots, even when you aim in the same spot. This is nowhere near as bad as it was in the original, but it's still there. This next problem is incredibly minor, but the names of chosen weapons don't appear anymore. They did in the N64 and old PC editions. Why take away a tiny bit of convenience? Earlier, I deemed the weapon wheel a genius move, but it doesn't always work in your favor. Every so often, you'll need to change to something else in a pinch. However, you might end up wielding the wrong weapon. For example, here I want to sneak attack this end trail with the Warblade, but accidentally I pull out the tech bow and waste an explosive arrow. In another moment, I wanted to use the plasma rifle, but Joshua kept equipping the shredder. I thought I was moving the analog stick to the middle right, but it has to be very specific. BioShock and Doom 4 do better with this by either freezing the action or slowing it down. What also really blows are enemy surprise attacks. Sometimes when you come to a corner or an intersection or pass through a door, a creature gets a cheap shot in. Whether it's a close quarters foe like a Raptoid or the many, many stationary snipers, suffering from this stupid problem doesn't add to the challenge, period. However, the biggest problem is the level design. The difficulty in many games stems from things like the toughness of rivals, the lack of health items, or dumb handicaps like psychic AI and getting knocked back when hit. Turok 2's difficulty lies in its world structure. It's like Quake 2's levels on steroids or even Donkey Kong 64 in first person. There is a massive amount of areas in each level, all large or huge in size. Not to mention, 80% of most levels have the same blasted design. Large room, long corridors. Large room, long corridors. It's boring. The main goal of each level is to complete objectives and locate keys to unlock more levels. But this is a nuisance because of how the places are structured. You are required to pass 1-7 or more sections to reach only part of an objective. Remember me bringing up the many branching pathways, teleporters, walkways, and floors? Well, they are the main problems. Enter one map, kill enemies, flip a few switches perhaps, step into teleporter, repeat one or more times before completing a task segment. So, chancing upon objective pieces can take as little as 5 minutes to over 2 hours! The extra areas only exist to artificially extend the length of the adventure. On top of those irritations, you'll also have to collect keys to the Primogen's Lair, sacred talismans, eagle feathers, and optionally, parts of a nuke weapon. You have to know and remember which portals lead where, and the on-screen map doesn't help much. But this also brings up yet another problem, backtracking. This isn't necessarily a bad thing. Tons of good games have backtracking. However, it only works if the stages have flow, they aren't so big, and everything doesn't look the same. I'll use Zelda Ocarina of Time for comparison. All the important items in each dungeon can be obtained right then and there. Plus, the map and compass put your mind at ease because they mark unvisited rooms, unopened chests, and which floor the boss is on. Now imagine if there was an item vital to finishing the game you couldn't get unless you clear another dungeon 100% first. For example, the Megaton Hammer needed to complete the Fire Temple is instead in the Shadow Temple, and the Shadow Temple must be finished first.
That's exactly what Turok 2 does.
See this talisman pad in level 1? It can't be used until level 2 is beaten first, and there's a Primogen key on the platform over there. Worse, this problem can occur frequently. Finish one level, return to a previous level, and painstakingly search for the important artifact you found about 5 or more hours ago. Hundreds of steps forward, hundreds of steps back. That is, unless you complete the worlds in a specific order after level 1. For example, world 3, then 2, return to world 1 for the Primogen key, continue with level 5, then 4, then 6, and finally go back to world 5 for its Primogen key. That's one order I know of where the least amount of backtracking is involved. Still though, how would you know to do that the first time? It's like the Mega Man series. Finish the stages in an order that doesn't require so much revisiting. You'll pretty much have to jot down notes to assist you in knowing exactly where significant things are or purchase a strategy guide. I sometimes forget or don't know where the unreachable items are, so I'm cursed to scour the whole level once more. I don't understand how anyone would find this pleasurable. The Zelda series did the same type of thing, but previous impassable areas usually lead to extra goodies that aren't of the utmost importance. And if crucial places and things are involved, retracing your steps back to an important place is easy since the areas you travel among don't look exact and it doesn't take agonizingly long. There are many areas in Turok 2 that look the same and it's too easy to get lost. Now, I'm not finished yet. If you happen to fail a mission, you're transported back to the very start of the world upon touching a level exit. This can be helpful considering some areas in certain levels become inaccessible after making a large amount of progress. At the same time, however, this feels like a cruel punishment. Not all levels are bad, though. The best worlds are the Port of Adia and the Death Marshes. The size of the Port of Adia is close to great. Crucial items, objectives, and warp portals are positioned in such a way that a near comfortable length of exploring is present. It also is a bit hard to get lost. Beware of the Compsognathuses, though. They're very small, they come in groups, and they're really quick in their movement and attack speed. The Death Marshes have an ample amount of wide open spaces, making it easy to get around and locate what's needed for accomplishment. It's also a sniper's paradise, so the tech bow and plasma rifle work in your favor extremely well. The only irritations in the Death Marshes are hunting for satchel charges to blow up the ammo facilities, the Perlin juggernauts, and the occasional swamp wasps. If the rest of the game were like these worlds, I would classify Seeds of Evil as one of the greatest FPSs of all time. Sadly, afterward, this is where it goes downhill. The Styracosaurus section in the River of Souls, while being a breath of fresh air, goes on for far too long, taking upwards of 15 to 20 minutes to finish. There is a good section or two in this level, like unlocking a big door with two keys and swimming underwater to flip a switch. But the rest is where the diverging paths, tight corridors, and similar-looking areas become very plentiful, so use the map like your life depends on it. Your worst foes in level 2 will be zombies. No matter how much you try to dodge their blood attacks and no matter how far away you are, they will always connect unless you use a piece of cover. Before you tell me that turning off the blood in the options also lowers the damage dealt by the zombies' blood attacks or outright disables the attack, that simply won't work in the remaster. Though it helps in keeping your vision from being briefly obstructed by splatters.
Level 4, the Lair of the Blind Ones, is where the annoyance factor begins to skyrocket. You'd better be as patient as a mother bird warming her eggs at this point.
Even though there's only one objective to complete, players will now have to contend with a series of holes to be dropped down in addition to teleporters, large complicated maze after large complicated maze, obtaining well-hidden cave keys, and small groups of platforms to jump on. And on top of that, there's a labyrinth that's almost entirely underwater. Unless you've experienced the lair yourself, you have no idea how tedious this place is. Many say the fourth level is the poorest world, but the Hive of the Mantids, level 5, definitely dethrones the Lair of the Blind Ones. At the very, very start, you're attacked by two turrets. Really? You pull off cheap shots at the beginning? No one will know this is coming their first time playing. This is kind of like Star Evil from Action 52, the game whose first level has an obstacle smack dab at the start. Did you think leaping to stationary platforms were bad? How about moving platforms? There are also force field generators to destroy, unlocking more rooms. And just like level 4, there are too many areas that look the same. If you hated having to deal with the compies and spiders before, get ready to deal with more than triple the amount, now in the form of giant mites and mantid workers. These stinking beasties can decrease your life points like it's nobody's business. But once you obtain the Firestorm Cannon, Flamethrower, and PFM layer, the anger level should go down. The aforementioned creatures aren't the worst problem. The baddest problem Hive of the Mantids has is this. there's an area with life force pickups leading to a wall. Throughout the entire adventure, life forces are placed in such a way that they are hints, reminding you via your naked eyes what areas you have yet to explore. But here, this wall is exactly the same texture as all the others. My first time playing, I thought nothing of it and struggled on. Nowhere could I locate the generator that powers the force field blocking the hallway to the talisman chamber. I didn't know that hallway was important, though. Then I realized there are walls you can destroy, but with all the random patterns, I thought they were part of the scenery.
Now hold that thought. Remember that other wall I talked about? The one that doesn't look the least bit interactive? Well, guess what? It is interactive!
I found this out not by complete accident, but by looking at a walkthrough because I was totally stumped. How is a player supposed to know there's a room beyond that wall? There is no indication that the life force trail continues. Did the developers expect everyone who bought this game to be clairvoyant? But now you know, so no complaining. Later on, there's another plain-looking wall that's destructible. Level 5 in Turok 2 is a good example of how not to make a complex environment. The last environment to explore is the Primogen's lightship, and it takes 6 keys to unlock the entrance to that place. The lightship is better overall than levels 4 and 5. It is smaller, objective-specific items are easy to track down, and many teleporters transport you back to the first map. Being that this is the last world, it also has the toughest enemies, one of which happens to be Primogen Troopers, the only mobile hitscan type enemy. Just like the Mantid Mites and Workers, these guys can take away large chunks of health. In spite of that, the most painful foe to deal with are sudden turrets. You don't know they're there unless you round a corner or do something else, and unless you turn the music down, you probably can't hear them being deployed. On top of that, there are too many of them, and they never take a break. My first time playing, I was sneak attacked 10 times by them. 10 times!
Jiminy Crickets Iguana Entertainment, enough is enough!
The ship's Primogen key is a different story. You're not required to re-enter the lightship after finishing another level to obtain the key, thank goodness. Instead, players must turn off individual generators powering a force field surrounding the key, using switches scattered around the vessel. One of them is in a room only accessible via the pool in a particular recalibration chamber, and it's super easy to miss. So, go over every individual pool with a fine-tooth comb. Turok 2 features 4 bosses. 3 appear at the end of levels 4, 5, and 6. The last one is beyond the locked center entrance in the hub. Interestingly, half of them are fun to fight while the other half is obnoxious. The Mantid Queen tends to leap after you infinitely if you keep your distance before closing the gap, and Mother sends out fast hopping enemies constantly during the first phase. The ginormous Blind One and the Primogen are the fun battles. Should you defeat the last boss, the Primogen, breathe a big sigh of relief, for Turok 2 Seeds of Evil has finally concluded. After an average of 30 to 40 hours of playtime, I'd say the player has seen far more than enough. Now onto the multiplayer and the cheats. What I dislike about the multiplayer feature is that it's via online only, no local playstyle with bots. Such a thing would have been great. It would give players a chance to practice and familiarize the arenas before facing human opponents. The remaster contains 7 game modes, 3 of which are the rudimentary deathmatch, team deathmatch, and last man standing scenarios. The other 4 are more thought-provoking. Frag Tag involves each player in a random order becoming a monkey and needing to reach a certain spot to return to normal before perishing. Rock Mix is about each player spawning with a random weapon, and Insta-Rock has competitors spawning with a plasma rifle with unlimited ammo as their only weapon. Raptor Fest is a survival scenario where players fend off never-ending waves of enemies from the main game. Choosing who to play as is important. Each character differs in health, armor, speed, and whether or not their health regenerates. The Raptor is the only character who can't use firearms. As for the cheats, everything from the original is still there. This time, though, Adon mocks you when a cheat is activated.
You should be ashamed of yourself.
There's a brand new cheat called Flight Mode. Aside from having the ability to fly, it also greatly increases your speed. I'm not sorry to use this once in a while because these levels, well, you already know how huge they are.
Even with the wonderful improvements, the big question is, do I recommend this game? Well, sort of. Don't get me wrong, there are elements of Turok 2 Seeds of Evil that I really like. The weapons, the enemy variety, and the audio are all lovely. Plus the addition of the hint system, quick warp feature, and being able to save anywhere is a huge load off anyone's back. But the convoluted worlds and surprise attacks are blemishes on an otherwise fairly solid game. That said, I wouldn't recommend it over Turok 3 Shadow of Oblivion, and I know that sounds somewhat crazy.
The third installment's main game mode feels like a step down compared to its predecessor. Its arsenal seems less interesting, and its level design is a walk in the park, but after Seeds of Evil's fatiguing chore-style campaign, Shadow of Oblivion felt like what a video game ought to feel like, a well-flowing adventure without hassle. In other words, relaxing. And after all, isn't that what video games are supposed to be like? Relaxing? I'm not saying developers should cater to casual gamers. What I'm saying is, if you're going to create a Labyrinth-style game, make it so that it doesn't overstay its welcome. And if a player has to resort to using guides to win, then it proves bigger doesn't always equal better. So to all those who say Seeds of Evil is the greatest of the Turok series, we must simply agree to disagree. To be fair, the first three Turok games weren't created with everyone in mind.
Nevertheless, many thanks Night Dive Studios for creating a more accessible version of Turok 2 Seeds of Evil. And to the viewers, thanks for watching.